So, hello everyone, and welcome to this new streaming. It's the 21 March today, and I hope the microphone sound is good, and you also receive the video quality and everything. So, I get a lot of messages on the chat, also on IRC, so it's hard to focus on something right now, but thank you for all your presence. I know it's not a very good time zone for everyone, so thank you for doing the effort, especially to those in the USA and in all the America who have to wake up very early for following this stream, or the one who also are in Asia and it's very late at night. So thank you for doing all this effort. Today we will do the second part of shading this artwork. I see it under. Yeah, and if you missed the first part, you can see always later the video is in the description of the video, and also all the previous live stream are stored in the video description of this live stream, and the address of this live stream is not changing. So sorry, I will put the right setup to record only the desktop, maybe adding a little camera in the corner, like that, and preparing my tablet. So I have my files here. So today we will work on getting from this step, this step, that's where we went last time, and we go to this step first. So adding a little shading and texture, and this step, making all the detail perfect and all the little ambient and the depth in the picture and everything. So I'm looking a bit at the chat. Hello everyone. So it's really hard for me to read everything. I'm just overreading every time. So if you want to make a question or something directly to me so I can answer it, feel free to quote my name. There is certainly a system, because I see it, the line in red or something. It helps to attract my attention during the stream and answer your question. Thank you. So we will start where we stopped last time, and it was at this step. I will open it in Krita. Okay, and I will just put this chat windows always on top, so it's always visible. And also, I'm checking if Krita, if my tablet is well set up, because I'm always changing things. So last time we colored all the little island here with a flat color, and I gave some tips to adapt the color to make it to color this very fastly with a mask that is naming the colorist mask. And then we added just a little pass here. It was a hard light, a layer with just pure violet, just to reduce all the color to fit in the same palette and also to add a little ambient. Okay. And today, loading up. Today, I'm gonna start with this shade layer. So we have here is the full stack. This is all the layer hidden here are the final artwork, because it's an artwork I did. But here I just make visible this layer. It's a paint layer named a shade, and it's in hard light also, because I really like hard light, and I will probably start to explain what does the hard light layer. So the hard light is in the category lighten. It's probably a problem to be in the category lighten. Maybe it was sorted in Krita in this category because the name was hard light and lighten, maybe. but it's probably an arithmetic one, and I will show you why. So I will name it shade demo to be sure to be on this layer, and I will put a color like orange to be sure to be on it. And then this type of layer, if I pick a perfect gray here on my palette and just a hairbrush, and if I paint, you'll see that it does nothing. Even if on the layer you have some gray painted. It's because this layer paint bright things from the middle gray to the bright gray and shade dark from the black to the middle gray. And so it's two blending mode into one layer. On the upper part of the gray, it will switch to a screen blending mode. So it's a blending mode to make things brighter like this, you can see. And if I go down here under the mid gray, it will transform into a multiply blending mode. So why I'm using this and not two layers like a multiply and a screen blending mode on split layer? It's because on my object here, I often doesn't need to get shading and at the same time lighting in the same area. It doesn't make sense. If the area needs to be bright, it doesn't need to be dark at the same time. So for me, it was necessary to find a blending mode that can do both. And hard light was a good candidate. I tested in the past a lot of them. The grain merge was really good, overlay also, but these two made some too strong saturation. So with this hard light, I can start to make some global light on my scene. Just for example, putting this very light airbrush light here and start to darken maybe a bit the edge of the scene at the same time. So before doing more shading on the character and everything, I will look at the chat. So up, going a bit. Good. I'm happy to know that the sound is working because I tweaked my microphone recently and I wasn't sure. Hard light is a combo of divide and multiply. Divide? Probably, maybe, but it looks really like screen. Any types for managing layers in Krita? How do such a great job at it, but I find myself confusing my layer while I'm working. I'm just using the color code and really small name. Just a single word, compact name. And the one I don't really need to touch anymore, I put them into gray. So that's how I manage the layer. You see this one and this one are gray. And small words to try to not do mistake with them. Wow, I see so many comments, very nice, thank you. So for shading, at first, I will do something really quickly on the top of my on my layer stack, but just to explain you something, and I will reduce the opacity. I will consider all the shape of my artwork like simple volume. For example, the head of this cat, I will consider them like this and with two, three angles like that. Just as in a low polygon video game. This has a cylinder, this has another cylinder, this has a sphere, and here another sphere. Another sphere, no, it's not a sphere, it's like a tube. And this in the background like a big square. big cubes even, because square, it's a flat shape, and this is cubes with the surface. So by making all this volume very simplified in my head, of course, I'm not drawing that when I'm doing the color, but I keep that in mind. When I do all of this, it's helped me to just focus at first on shading the right part of the artwork. There is some big block to shade for at first. And so, if I have my light source, for example, on this artwork, I think I picked here a light source coming like that from the moonlight. And the moonlight is probably here somewhere, but we can't see it. So it's almost parallel ray of light. So I would get this part more dark because this wall is not exposed directly to the light. This one will be exposed to light, so maybe a bit brighter. Here I will get a cast shadow, so these are stronger than usual on all this part. And all the cat here will be on this type of value. It's because it's in the shadow. And then I will get here a shadow and here also a shadow, like that, casted shadow, so darker. And then I will do the bounce light. So the light bounces on this wall and lights the face of this character. And light a little part of this and little part here and here. So this is a really simple rig and really simple way to manage the light. And I explained this with simple shape because it's a bit more cryptic when I do it on the shading layer. So I keep using a preset like that, not at full opacity, and I pick just under the mid gray, just a bit darker here, and I start to shade what I told you I would do. Up. So big block first. You see, I'm not really focusing on making the little volume of the little mouse or the nose of the cat or everything. It's big block first, always. And also, I don't focus to be really clean. You see that this edge, I will fix the edge. So the shadow going outside of the wall later. I'm just picking a big brush and trying to get the right shading. For her, maybe like that. So you can play to make a lot of things with shading. A lot of expression. Oops, sorry. I'm just adding a big block here and I want to erase it. And by saying you can play with things is if you put something in light like that, you will attract attention and focus on your scene on it. And if you put something in dark, like the little mouse in the corner, you will put some detail that doesn't need to be seen at first but will be seen after. And because we are on a blending mode that can accept also color, you can also play with colored light. So for example, I have the light of the moon going from here, bouncing on this wall, and this wall maybe with the ambient and with the brick color and everything, the moon, the light that is refracted is getting a little bluish. So I can use this little blue light to go like that on this part, and also this wall also a bit. So by using a big brush like that, you can quickly see if the light source is good here, or if you prefer to go for another light source, maybe turn the the moonlight in the other side maybe make a dramatic effect and like an alarm red light here that can helps you to make some volume a bit more visible here maybe. But all this path is really flat, so all your colors here and all your volume are still very flat with this path. So that's why it's only the first step. For the edges, you can use a tool like the move tool here. Here, this one. And just push your shadow to respect a bit more your edges. Sometimes it's good to can also play with moving a shadow around like that. Or if you shake it, you can have a little blur, extra blur here, like that. It's good to soften a shadow edge. I really like to play with this type of tool. So because it's very flat, we need then to go into the detail. And for that, I'm using very often a simple brush with or flow and opacity on it at the same time. And I'm picking the local color, so I press Ctrl, Alt at the same time, and it pick only the color on this layer, because as you can see, my layer has now some shading color on it. So I can pick just the color of the layer with Ctrl and Alt together, press on the keyboard. And I see that I'm showing my face now on the webcam. It's not useful. Maybe it's better if I manage to show. Yep. What? I'm afraid the webcam will fall because it's ready. But yeah. So Ctrl and Alt here on the keyboard, and you can sample just the color of the layer, not. If you press Ctrl only, it will sample all the color, the resulting color on your screen. But with Ctrl and Alt, you can pick just the color on your layer. So you can find back what was your color of light or of shadow here or here. So then it's a game of going small and starting to make this little shadow that are in corner of the picture. And it's sort of in 3D it's called they call them the ambient occlusion one. So when two objects touch together, it's getting dark, because even if there is a lot of ray of light everywhere, this part gets darker because it's hard for the light to go on it. So you can work on this type of shading and also on little shadow, like for example this chicken things can do a little shadow here, because we have this light coming ding ding, and so there is a little casted shadow. But if it looks like the cat is droning or something, drilling, I don't know, but when there is a lot of saliva and everything there. So sometimes you need to play with making it accurate depending the light, or making it visually looking good. That depends how much style you want to put in your picture. So you understood how to shade like that. And I will not so shade every little part of the scene in live. It's only this to show you some technique. And if I need to lighten, because this material, for example, shine a bit because in front of the camera it receives some light. So I can put some light refraction on it, like on the banana also a bit. And what I like with this technique is also I can keep blending only the light and not the underneath color. So for example, if I take one of the blending mode, like not blending mode, but blending brush, like this knife, I can blend only the shading and the material and get an effect on it. And you can see that if I do this between the color, it doesn't really break the edge because there is still the color that makes some area very, very split. But maybe for this, I just need something softer, like that. So it helps me to get some effect on the surface of object and managing my what is shining and what is not shining. So I can pick then after something and just draw a bit like this, like that. So at first it was the big block with a brush a bit blurry. Then we add some little shading and also reflection. And in third path, what I do, still on this same layer, is I add some texture. Because I often get some very flat area around the drawing. So what I'm doing is I often just scribble a bit, a little texture on the part that deserves to receive a texture. So sometimes it's little dot on the floor, like that. Because this layer is not only good for shading, but you can also use it to do some color, little color variation. So if you need a little bit of noise on something, or I'm not using it when there is a decals, like a picture you put on the... In the beginning, quality was very good. Now it sucks. Oh, the quality of the video or the quality of my speech, Dr. Hoffman? Sorry. Sorry if it's technical. And if it's about what I say, sorry too. So, you have some texture here, and you have the big block, the little shading and texture, and that's, with more work of course, what I did when I did this one. So, you will see the little shading, the big block, and texture. This texture of watercolor is... Yes. Probably this brush in the watercolor set and just big splash of black like this, or maybe a color a bit more reddish like that. Yes. Yes, for the quality of video, sorry, it depends the YouTube server and also my internet access. Soon video quality is fine here too. So you can see here, for example, some rake effect on the wall. This all little stroke adds some life because I'm trying to break the feeling of the flat textures on the artwork. Making a flat colored artwork is very fast with the quick mask tool, as we saw on the live stream previously. But if I'm using these techniques, I need some tips to break a bit the digital aspect. So one step I keep adding is another pass of texture sometime. And this time is with soft light SVG. But as you saw, you can do it on the hard light. Maybe for this artwork, I was a bit zealous to make two pass of texture. Maybe one is just necessary. And then I advise a paint layer. So this is just a paint layer on the top, because getting all of this shading with a problem, with everything, with textures, I think it's really good to just take back a paint layer, a simple paint layer, and with a little brush like this one, and just For example, adding details manually, picking the color, and shading a little part you want to shade manually. So for the shininess of the trash can, I preferred to make them in paint layer on this one. So it's a paint layer, but all of this is still under the ink and frame. So I'm still working. If I paint, I still paint under the line. And at this step, what I do also on my line is also I start to lock the alpha. So there is a little lock alpha here. And this little lock alpha, if your lines, I will just not select opaque, but isolate the layer. Oops. Sorry, I selected all the pixels on the layers, not the things I wanted to do. Just isolate the layer. Yes. So now we can see only the alpha, so the transparent color, and the line. So as my line, as you saw on the previous stream, are on a single layer, I can lock them and then paint on them a color. So as you can see on this drawing, I just drew this line in yellow for the smell. I will just move back. So this line were part of the line art, but I preferred to get them in white. And the fur of the cat here was maybe too strong in black. So I just picked a brush and a color. I'm picking a pink, so it's really visible, and so I can paint only the line if I want on this layer. So this is small adjustment because I saw that if I kept the color of the original line art, the transition was a bit, the contrast also with the white fur and this contrast was a bit too strong. You see the line, the underline is too big. It makes a stylization effect that I don't like, just. So I prefer to make it more bright. And I know artists who do it for every material, so they pick just the color here, reduce the opacity, and paint to get all the line matching the color. It does a very soft effect, and it's something I like also, the colored line effect, but it takes time and I'm not fond of getting it over all the artwork. Sometime on Pepper and Carrot I do it, you can see it on the comics, but I try to only use it on specific object when the contrast is really hard to, feels very hard to me. So I will have a look at the chat. Can you explain more on how you decide on lighting? What color use for shading? Yes, that's the right moment for this. So when I made this layer on the top to decide the direction, sure, I didn't pick this direction for nothing. For example, in this artwork, I will just remove all the shading, painting and texture. I will show you what alternative I could have. So if the light, for example, if I had like a, sorry, I probably need to create a new layer on top with hard light just to make some quick notes. Well, so if I had like a car in front and light, or maybe a street with a lot of light here, I would have this part like this here and this part in shadow. So they would have strong silhouette for sure. But because I want these two parts of the drawing to be read at first, when we open this artwork, it's not a very good choice. If I want the other way around, so making all of this dark, like this is the night, and we have the shadow coming from here. This is like a flash, you know, when you take, you pick a photo and you are in front and you are also the camera and the source of light. And this is not a very good choice because it makes everything appear in distance here very mysterious. So I would have picked this if we had like a monster in background like this. And I wanted to make the picture underline the mysterious effect of this and a contrast between this scene being fun and this scene being mysterious. Because this light is not, it's not bad, because you can get your character very lightened with a very front light, but it just depends what you want to storytell. The lighting is really a storytelling device. With choosing the one from this side, as I did, and getting this in light and this a bit in secondary light with the boons, it allows me to get people to get the context maybe first, then move to the next character here and see her face and then understand why she does this face. So it's like getting a little round in the picture and to try to play with that. And this is just how I design. If I was putting the light on the other sense, on the other direction, sorry for my English, here, it would have been much more complicated for me maybe to storytell exactly the same story. Even if here I can expect like a boons of light here. So as you can see, playing with sketching the light is really quick. You can pick a big airbrush and just do some sketch. So this allows you to see quickly what to do, what will serve your picture or not. And then for the color of shadow, the shadow doesn't really have color, so you can't really advise pick always this color and it will be always good. I know that there is a lot of artists in comic that says, hey, pick a desaturated violet and it works every time, but it's more complicated than that. A color, a single color, a bit desaturated with a bit of gray will work most of the time, because the truth is a shadow is just the lake of light. There is no light on the part, but there is still some light. If there would be no light at all, it would be pure dark, pure black even. You wouldn't see anything. And the fact you see something in the shadow is there is some light. In a scene like that, it's a light that comes maybe from the sky. The sky is a big source of light. So it's a little blue like this that comes even coloring the shadow. Even if the source of light is very, for example, yellow everywhere on the scene, the part where the yellow color is not touching, it's what we name the shadow, and this shadow is filled with another source of light. It can be also a red light that is here. So there is always a light, always a little light that is filling the shadow. So that's why if you pick a color for the shadow, for example, you pick a dark blue, it's because you know that you are not painting really a shadow. You are removing a bit of light and replacing by a very low light in blue. So it's just how you turn it around in your mind. You not pick a color to paint a shadow, but you try to emulate some work of light. And by removing light, it just means going darker and darker. So I hope I answered this question. Sorry to be a bit long about it. Or pick dark violet on almost any kind of shadow part because we need to save time. Yes, I understand this type of production tips with people who pick always the same shadow, but when I look at their artwork, for me it looks industrial. Colored line also sometimes end up making your character looks like they glow. Yes. It's good. It's a good tips for glowing effect, but I do totally agree. Ah, good. So let's move on and going back to not the shadow, the texture, paint, contrast, and repaint. So now I will speak about the last step. And the last step, when you reach this coloring, for a lot of artists, they are ready to publish like that, and it's okay. But here I like to put some things over on the top of the stack. So the first thing I do is a layer that I named DOF for depth of field. Sorry, I have a bit of problem with pronunciating the F. So depth of field. And it's a layer with the lighten mode. And this lighten mode paint only, it's a bit complicated for me with my limited vocabulary to explain, but if you put some violet color on it, like this bright violet, and if the line are dark under, the violet will only affect the dark line. The lighten means it will lighten only the part of the picture that are dark, maybe darker than your color. Sorry, it's a bit confusing, but you will see quickly how you can play with it. For example, on the background, all the line were too strong. And without this, the character looks almost for me at the same weight than this character and this character. Visual weight, it's a sort of contrast. And by adding this, it's like adding a distance fog on the scene. So the more distant the object are, and the less visible they will be, because the line will be sort of lightened. I can show you with if I had a pass of sorry, just made too much of undo, and now I don't know why, but I have like ghost layer. Oops, here. So on this layer, if I pick some green, yes, and you will see you can get some fog effect in the distance. So this is really extreme, but I was hoping it was like a nice demo to show the content of this layer property. And if you use the hue saturation and darken a bit like that, you can see how it push things into the distance, because all the low value are affected by this layer, and then you can paint things to be really more distant. I also use this layer, this lighten layer, when I could have used it here to add some smell or some effect on the top, because it's really good at overriding a bit the dark part of the picture. And if you pick a very low color like that, It can also just put all your scene on a sort of fog. So that's why I name it depth of field. Maybe it's not a very good one, but I always use it to when I have my background that has some line and I want to calm down a bit. Like that. Then the next is a ambient color. ambient color, so it's just a filter. And by filter, I mean like a manual filter. It's a layer filled with a single color. Here it's violet. And it's in color blending mode at 10%. So if I put it at 100%, it will color all my picture into only shade of violet. It's not what we want. But if I reduce it to 10%, for example, it will just subtly do some influence on all the shade of the picture. So it helps again to tie all the palette together. Sometimes I have some here, the orange of the cat, that was maybe too different of the scene, that the color, and I really like it because it makes a comic effect with color very different. But if I want to make the color a little bit more realistic, I know that adding just a 10% in color mode over all my artwork at the end just helps to make the picture colors like if they all live together. And then it's adjustment. So there is one that I really like is the saturation layer. And on the saturation layer, what you paint on it is just some stain to manage the saturation of the picture. So this is when, for example, the cat was now good for the color, for the hue, but it was not really attracting the eyes. So putting a saturation just a little bit higher, I don't know if with the video compression if you can see the difference between this and that, and it might depend also of your screen, but it's like making the color a little bit fruity. And also use this to reduce the saturation. So on this part, I reduced the saturation as well. Yes, it was on the bananas. The bananas was a bit too glowy, so I reduced it to be a bit more grayish, to not stall the focus point. And then just a normal paint over. Because with all this lasagna of layers, with all these layers of layers of layers, there is things that you can't control, and getting just a normal paint layer on the top for last minute fix. So for example, the white of the eyes here. It's 10 times easier to fix them in the top layers at the last minute than to go back on all the stack and try to know when I should have put this a little bit brighter. So it's a little paint layer, and on this paint layer, I'm doing usually little white spot or little correction. It's very subtle. Sometimes, yes, I redraw, for example, the character. They were very, not a lot of details, so I quickly add tiny detail on the top. And then the last filters I'm using, and this is a filter, it's a sharpened filter. So this is here on the little add a new layer, and you add a filter layer. So you will get this dialogue, and if you go to enhance and sharpen, you can add like a sharpen filter like this on the top. So this type of layer are very resource intensive. If you want to paint back on your picture, I advise you to put off the visibility. But if you press them on, you will see that the detail will get a lot crispier on the screen. So you will get from something blurry like that to something very sharp like that, with all the detail about your textures, like here on the wall, very visible. So obviously the default setting of the sharpen filter is a bit extreme. You can see it's very noisy. So when I use one, for example, mine is here, I reduce the opacity of the filter. Here, just 30%. It's just to go from this to this, to get a little gain. So all the texture pop a bit more like that. And it's looking a bit better in my opinion. But yes, it has a drawback. You have to deactivate it each time if you want to go back painting your picture and reactivating it, then to get this this type of sharp result. And here there is another layer, but I think, yes, that's just my notes on the top. So that's all for this shading method. And if you have now question, I will just look at the chat during 5 minutes and answer them. And depending the answer, then I will finish the little live stream. So, wow, a lot. Oh boy, we reached 100 viewers. Oh, thank you. Okay, so it was here. Depth of field. Yes, my accent. What is Pepper and Carrot about? It's a webcomic with a little witch and her cat. And you can find it on pepperandcarrot.com. It's probably in the video description. Is Krita an awesome program? Of course. Can it be used to make anime backgrounds? Sure, it can. Time to make hentai. Oh my god. Thank you, Franco. David, do you use Python scripting feature in Krita 4? Taiman, sorry, I don't know a lot how to write things in Python. I'm a Python, not scripter, tweaker. I change a number here and there on already existing script. So right now I just look at the script and I just enjoy looking at them and using them as a user. But not yet, I'm not making my own script. It will come with time. I need to learn more Python. When learning the technical side of Krita, did you look at tutorial or did you self-teach? At that time, there wasn't a lot of tutorial. It was back in 2009 or 2010, almost 10 years ago now. And it was really easy to find the feature I was needing. So, and there is also another effect. If you learned a painting software, it can be Photoshop, Corel Painter or something. And when you open another new painting software, you might not be able to manage 100% of the feature at first, but you can really, really quickly find everything you need very quickly, because the vocabulary is the same, because all the features, they do things differently, but you know, you already know what you want to do as effect, and you can see directly, oh, this is a brush, this is where the blending mode are, this is the layer stack and this is the filters. And when you get all this logical brick, you can quickly already start to paint in any software. So it was really quick to get the first fundamental of Krita, and then I started to make the tutorial to make more tutorial about it. Any advice in layouting comic? I mean, in planning the layer, do you usually do one panel, one file? Aha! So, for this, the best is to dive in a real comic page. I go in my Pepper and Carrot folder in my webcomic, and I will pick episode with a lot of layers. So maybe this one. No, I showed it last week. So yes, this one. And first page. And you'll see the structures of my comic page. All the page and all the Krita files are on Pepper and Carrot. So if you want to open this file, you can go on Pepper and Carrot, go to the source category, and then you will access to every Krita files of every 100 page I made of Pepper and Carrot. But I usually lay out Pepper and Carrot page by page because it's more convenient for publisher, and being published for Pepper and Carrot is one of the target of the project also. So having a diffusion on paper printed. So I started Pepper and Carrot with the strip format, making all the panel on the same page for all the episode. And then I started to break down everything page by page. And my file, my layer structure is like that. So I will turn all down. So usually what I have is on the top a frame layer. So this is a, I will just reactivate the line because it doesn't look good without the line. Poof, poof, poof. So the on the frame layer, oh, I converted it to a paint layer, this one. Yes, it was to make this little roundish border. So, but the frame layer is often a vector layer, so I can move the panel a bit when I need to adjust. And then I have my line, I have my painting under the line, and some things that I show you on this stream. So the fog effect, like this on the floor, it's a lighten, the depth of field, the DOF I couldn't really spell. Some highlight here for the little star and highlight on the character. So highlight can override all the line of the artwork like that. And then filters like sharpen. Here I have also a defocus, but this one is really resource intensive and I use it only on this episode. So the defocus is just a blur, a Gaussian blur. And I painted on this layer part really sharp and part very blurry. Here, because it's in foreground, it's a bit more blurry, you see? And it becomes a bit blurry. So it's just a focus, a Gaussian filter, a blur. And because on Krita, you can paint on filter layer. You can go to black if you don't want to remove all the effect, and in white to put the effect to the maximum. So here you can see that this is a blur filter. Up, painting it black again. So I get all the detail on her face, and here I can make the foreground a bit more blurry like that. Of course, it takes a lot of time to compute, so. A texture on the top, and this is just a slightly paper texture. So it's hard to show you because this is very subtle. maybe if I increase now the here, for example, you have a little paper texture if I enable and disable it. And this is just to make a little grain, a little aspect more traditional. A composition filter, it's just some composition line for me when I do the composition of the panel to get the element at 1/3. It helps me to compose my panel and to see where I want to frame things. Like that. Sorry, I will drink a bit of water. So I will just scan the chat for another question. Hello, David. Which Linux distribution are you using? Zveriok is doing an amazing work at replying everything. He's a Pepper and Carrot contributor. Thank him again for managing here. And he replied, well, it's Ubuntu 17.10 GNOME. Yeah, you can find it here. There is an ugly app image. Yes, app image of Krita, but the release of Krita is tomorrow. So Krita 4.0 will come very soon. So thank you very much again for I was just checking the chat before saying the last goodbye. So thank you very much for following again this live streaming. If you want to see later all the streaming, check in the description of the video. There is all the live streaming saved from the previous edition in the description. They are listed. It will take like 3 or 4 hours to get this one computed by YouTube to appear on the list. But in 2 or 3 hours, you will see the link. And also next week, I will try to do something traditional, maybe showing how I do my ball pen technique or how I draw on paper. I have a better webcam now. So thank you very much for following again. I'm repeating myself. Maybe I'm a bit tired this week. If you want to continue discussion, you can always go to pepperandcarrot.com. In the community part of the website, there is a link to our Telegram chat, IRC channel, and everything. And I will be on the IRC channel. So thank you very much and see you next week. Bye-bye.